Good morning all. Good morning students. Good morning. Okay. So in our last class, we were discussing about the dipole in a uniform magnetic field. So let us continue with the same derivation. Magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field. For that, here we consider a dipole and placed it is in a uniform magnetic field. Then this dipole is experiences a force. As a result of this, the magnetic dipole is undergoes a rotation inside this uniform magnetic field, and this rotational effect of this magnetic dipole is known as torque, and it is given by the equation tau is equal to mb sin theta. But here the rotation made by this dipole is very small. So we can equate this angle sin theta is approximately equal to theta, then the torque tau is equal to mb theta. Then by rotational analog of force, we have torque tau is equal to I alpha, where I is the current and alpha is not current, I is the moment of inertia. Here I is the moment of inertia. And alpha is the angular acceleration. Alpha is the angular acceleration. So this tau mb theta is obtained from this rotational effect of the torque. But from the rotational analog, we know that F is equal to ma. According to Newton's law, F is equal to ma. The rotational analog of force is torque, and that of the mass is moment of inertia. It is represented by I. And acceleration, according to rotational analog, we have angular acceleration. It is represented by alpha. So we have tau is equal to I alpha. So we can compare this equation 2 and 3. Then we get I alpha is equal to minus mb theta. And this minus sign is because of the restoring torque experienced by the dipole when it is placed in a uniform magnetic field. So from this equation, we get the angular acceleration alpha is equal to minus mb theta divided by I. Angular acceleration alpha is equal to minus mb theta divided by I. But according to the actual equation for the angular acceleration, actual angular acceleration is given by, what is the equation for calculating angular acceleration? The linear acceleration is the rate of change of velocity. Similarly, how we can calculate the angular acceleration? Already we discussed in our last class. Yes, it is the rate of change of angular velocity, that is d by dt of omega, where omega is the angular velocity. Omega is the angular velocity. And what is angular velocity then? Linear velocity is the rate of change of displacement. Similarly, angular velocity omega is rate of change of angular displacement, and the angular displacement is represented by theta. So here we have d by dt of theta. So here we substitute the value of this angular velocity omega in the equation for angular acceleration. The angular acceleration alpha become d by dt of d theta by dt. D theta by dt, or we can write alpha is equal to d square theta divided by dt square. So this is the expression for angular acceleration we obtained here according to our equation number 5. So this alpha is the angular acceleration that we are deriving from this derivation steps, and this is the actual equation for angular acceleration, that is angular acceleration alpha is given by the rate of change of angular velocity. It is given by d square theta divided by dt square. Now we can compare the equation number 4 and equation number 5. Because here the LHS of both equations are same, so we can equate this equation 4 and 5. Is there any steps up to here? Any doubt? Okay, so here we are going to equate the steps 4 and 5. By equating 4 and 5, we have d square theta by dt square is equal to minus mb theta by I. D square theta divided by dt square is equal to minus mb theta divided by I. Or we can take this term to the LHS of the equation. So it becomes d square theta divided by dt square. Then what happens to this equation? D square theta by dt square. I want to take this mb theta by I to the left hand side of the equation. It becomes
plus
d square theta by dt square plus mb theta divided by I is equal to 0. This is our equation number 6. Do you have any familiar with this equation? Any type of equation like this? In plus one physics, again, the plus one physics in chapter oscillation, you study an equation similar to this, equation of simple harmonic motion. Equation of simple harmonic motion. Okay, according to simple harmonic motion, write the next step. By simple harmonic motion, we have an equation d square x divided by dt square plus omega square x equal to 0. This is the equation for simple harmonic motion in the chapter oscillation. You are already studied in your previous year. D square x divided by dt square plus omega square x is equal to 0. So this is our equation number 7. So by the derivation, we have d square theta by dt square plus mb theta divided by I is equal to 0. Then a similar equation you have already studied in the chapter oscillation for simple harmonic motion. That equation is given by d square x divided by dt square plus omega square x is equal to 0. So now we can compare the equation number 6 and that of the equation number 7. So according to equation number 6, we have d square theta divided by dt square plus mb theta I. Mb theta divided by I is equal to 0. So here this x represents linear velocity. Okay, here the first equation, equation number 7, the x represents linear velocity. This is the linear velocity. Correspondingly, in equation number 6, we have another velocity is this. What is this theta represents? What is theta represents? Angular acceleration is the rate of change of angular velocity. And what is angular velocity? It is the rate of change of angular displacement. Okay, sorry, it is not linear velocity. This is linear displacement. Here this x represents linear displacement. Similarly, what is this theta represents?
Angular displacement.
It is the angular displacement. Angular displacement. So here we are comparing the equation that we are deriving here with that of the equation in simple harmonic motion. So d square divided by dt square, it is representing a rate of change of something. So in the seventh equation, it is the rate of change of linear velocity. But in the sixth equation, it is the rate of change of angular velocity. Sorry, not velocity, displacement. Where x represents the linear displacement and theta represents the angular displacement. Now we can compare the second term. Here in seventh equation, we have omega square x. But in the sixth equation, we have mb theta divided by I. Here this x and this theta represents the linear displacement and the angular displacement respectively. Correspondingly to the equation omega square, here we have another term. What is that? Comparing equation 7 and 6. Here we have omega square. Corresponding to that term, we have one more term is there in equation number 6. What is that?
MB by I.
Yes, it is MB divided by I. Okay. Omega square is equal to MB divided by I. So by comparing the equation 6 and 7, write the next step. Comparing the equation 6 and 7, we have omega square is equal to MB divided by I. By comparing the equations 6 and 7, we have omega square is equal to MB divided by I. If omega square is equal to MB divided by I, then what is omega?
Cos MB divided by.
Yes. Then omega is equal to root of MB divided by I. This is our equation number 8. So this omega square is obtained by comparing the equation number 6 and 7. The equation number 6 is obtained from deriving the steps. From the derivation steps, we get that d square theta by dt square plus mb theta divided by I is equal to 0. Similar to this equation, we have another equation in simple harmonic motion for oscillation. That is d square x by dt square plus omega square x is equal to 0. Here x and theta representing the linear displacement and angular displacement respectively. And the second term, omega square, when we are comparing with that of the previous equation, we get omega square is equal to mb theta divided by I. And from that, omega is equal to root of mb divided by I. Where this omega is the angular velocity. Okay. And there is another relation between angular velocity and time period. According to the relation between, write the next step. According to the relation between angular velocity and time period, according to the relation between angular velocity and the time period, we have t is equal to 2 pi by omega. According to the relation between the angular velocity and the time period, we have t is equal to 2 pi by omega, which implies omega is equal to, from this equation, can you form an equation for omega? T is equal to 2 pi by omega, which implies omega is equal to
2 pi by t.
Yes, it is 2 pi divided by t. 2 pi by t. This is our equation number 9. Now just compare the equation number 8 with that of the 9. Comparing equation number 8 and 9. According to equation number 8, we have angular velocity omega is equal to root of mb divided by I. And here the relation between angular velocity and that of the time period, omega is equal to 2 pi divided by t. So here the equation number 8 and 9, the LHS of both equations are same. So we can equate it. So here we are going to equate equation number 8 and 9. Since their LHS are same, we can equate equation number 8 and 9. We get 2 pi divided by t is equal to root of mb by I. 2 pi by t is equal to root of mb divided by I. Yes, Achyut.
Here the m is capital or small?
Small m. It is our magnetic dipole moment. 2 pi by t is equal to root of mb divided by I. Then what is t represents t? From this equation, can you form an equation for our time period? 2 pi by t is equal to root of mb by I. 2 pi divided by t is equal to root of mb divided by I, which implies the time period t is equal to just rearrange the terms present in this equation. 2 pi by t is equal to root of mb by I. Therefore, time period t is equal to two pi into root of I by mb. T is equal to 2 pi into root of I by mb. So this equation is represents the time period of a dipole in an uniform magnetic field. This represents the time period of the magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field. That is the time taken by the magnetic field to rotate inside a uniform magnetic field. Here we are consider a magnetic dipole and placed it in a uniform magnetic field. When it is placed in a uniform magnetic field, it experiences a force. As a result of that, it undergoes a rotation. That rotation is known as torque. And here we are deriving an equation for the time taken by the magnetic dipole to undergo the rotation inside the uniform magnetic field. That time period is given by t is equal to 2 pi into root of I by mb. This represents the time period of the magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field. The time period of a magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field. Again, from the same equation, we can form the magnetic field produced by the magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field. For that, we can square the equation. It becomes, this is our equation number 10. Now, T square, T is equal to 2 pi into root of I by mb. Then what is T square? T square is equal to
I by
mb. Yes, what happens to this 2 pi? T square is equal to 4 pi square. We square the whole equations. Square both LHS and RHS. So we have T square is equal to 4 pi square into square root of I by mb into square root of I by mb, that is I by mb, which implies the magnetic field B is equal to here T square is equal to 4 pi square into I by mb. From that we can calculate the magnetic field B. B is equal to
4 pi square I by mt square.
Yes, 4 pi square I divided by mt square. This is the magnetic field produced by the dipole in a uniform magnetic field. B is equal to 4 pi square into I divided by mt square. magnetic field produced by the magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field. So here we derive the equation for two physical quantities. One is for time period. The time period or the time taken by the magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field is given by T is equal to 2 pi into root of I by MB. So from this equation, we can calculate the magnetic field, the next physical quantity. The magnetic field that is produced by the magnetic dipole placed in a uniform magnetic field, it is given by B is equal to 4 pi square into I by MT square. Okay. Now we want to calculate one more physical quantity for this magnetic dipole that is placed in a uniform magnetic field. That is the potential energy, stored in the magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field. So you can give next subheading under this topic, potential energy stored inside the magnetic dipole placed in a uniform magnetic field. Potential energy stored in the magnetic dipole placed in a uniform magnetic field. So here we are starting with a magnetic dipole and kept it inside a uniform magnetic field, and we derive the equation for time period, the time taken by the magnetic dipole when it is placed in to undergo the rotation when it is placed in a uniform magnetic field. And again we derive one more equation for calculating the magnetic field experienced by this magnetic dipole when it is placed in a uniform magnetic field. Now we are going to find out the potential energy that is stored inside the magnetic dipole when it is placed in a magnetic field. So in order to derive the expression, we can start with the work done, by the magnetic dipole. Okay, the work done by the magnetic dipole is given by, because we know that the potential energy is a term that is associated with that of the work done of an object. Whatever may be the work done by an object, it may be stored in the form of a potential energy. So here we can start the derivation with the work done. The work done by the magnetic dipole is given by W is equal to, what is the equation for calculating the work done? Work done is equal to the general force equation. Yes, force into displacement. Force into displacement. The work done by the magnetic dipole is given by W is equal to force into displacement. For a small work done, we have, because we are already says that here this magnetic dipole is undergoes a small rotation. So for that it is so here the work done by the dipole is given by W is equal to force into displacement. For a small work done, we have dW is equal to, take the rotational analog of force. What is the rotational analog of force? dW is equal to torque. It is represented by tau. And the rotational analog of displacement.
Yes.
That is linear displacement. I want the rotational analog of displacement. That is angular displacement.
Theta.
So here the work done W is equal to F dot D. But here we are considering a small work done. Small work done is given by dW is equal to the rotational analog of force, that is torque, into the rotational analog of the displacement. This is displacement. And since it is a small rotation, here we can consider it as small angular displacement d theta. So dW is equal to tau into d theta. So from this expression, how we can calculate the total work done? Therefore, total work done is given by the small work done is given by dW is equal to tau d theta. Therefore, the total work done is given by the same procedure, integrating it. Integral dW is equal to integral, the integration is varies from theta 1 to theta 2 tau d theta. Integral dW is equal to integral theta 1 to theta 2 tau d theta, where dW is the small work done, tau is the rotational analog of the force, and d theta is the small angle of rotation. Integral theta 1 to theta 2 tau d theta. Okay. Integral of derivative of a function. Integral dW. What is that?
Theta 1 and theta 2.
Here we are going to derive the rotation. The rotation, the displacement, angle of rotation. The angle of rotation is varies from one point to another. From a stable equilibrium point to another. Here we are going to integrate this d theta function. That is why we are change this integration is varies from theta 1 to theta 2. We taken it as theta 1 to theta 2. This is a basic rule in integration in mathematics. So whatever be the, if for example, if it is a length, if you are wanted to integrate the length dl, then the integration is varies from L1 to L2. But here we are going to integrate the theta function, the angle of rotation or the small angular displacement d theta. That is why the integration is varies from theta 1 to theta 2. So it is depending upon the function that is we are going to integrate. We can change that upper limit and the lower limit. If it is a length, we can consider it as L1 to L2. If it is time, we taken it as T1 to T2. But here we are going to integrate the angular displacement d theta. That is the angle. That is why the integration is varies from theta 1 to theta 2. Is it okay?
Yes.
Okay. So integral dW is equal to integral theta 1 to theta 2 tau d theta. Again, what is integral dW?
W.
So here we have integral dW is equal to integral theta 1 to theta 2 tau d theta. Or we can write W is equal to, here this tau is a constant. We can, before that, what is tau? The torque, the rotational effect of a magnetic field. What is the equation for torque? In magnetism, we have torque in magnetism. Tau is equal to, what is the general equation for calculating tau?
MB sin theta.
Yes, tau is equal to MB sin theta. So here we can substitute the value of tau. So integral dW becomes W. W is equal to integral theta 1 to theta 2 mb sin theta. Mb sin theta d theta. Because the tau, that is the rotational effect of the magnetic dipole, that is given by tau is equal to mb sin theta. So here we are substituting the value of torque here. So we get W is equal to integral dW is nothing, it is the W itself. So W is equal to integral theta 1 to theta 2 mb sin theta d theta. Here this magnetic dipole moment m and the magnetic field b is constant, so we can take it outside. Therefore W is equal to mb into integral theta 1 to theta 2 sin theta d theta. Again the integration, recall the integral sin theta. I know that now you are studying that integration sin theta and d theta in mathematics, right? What is integral sin theta d theta?
That is term 2.
Which one?
Integration.
Integration is not over. Integral sin theta d theta.
No ma'am, that is in term 2.
Okay, all right. So here we are going to study about the integral sin theta d theta. In mathematics, we may study this equation. Integral sin theta d theta is equal to, what is d by dx of sin theta? Or d by d theta of sin theta? Derivative of sin theta?
Cos theta.
Cos theta. But in integration, the integral sin theta d theta is equal to minus cos theta. D by dx of sin theta, sin x is cos x. But here integration, integral sin theta d theta is equal to minus cos theta. This is an equation you studied in mathematics. You are going to study in mathematics in term 2. Integral sin theta d theta is equal to minus cos theta. Okay. So here we have integral sin theta d theta is equal to minus cos theta. So our equation becomes W is equal to mb into this integral sin theta d theta is minus cos theta, and this integration is varies from theta 1 to theta 2. W is equal to mb into minus cos theta. Integration is varies from theta 1 to theta 2. And now we can take this negative sign to outside. It becomes W is equal to minus mb. Now we can apply the limits, upper limit and the lower limit. It becomes cos theta 2 minus cos theta 1. W is equal to mb into integral sin theta d theta is minus cos theta. Then we are applying the limits theta 1 to theta 2. The integral theta 1 to theta 2. In the next step, we take this negative sign outside. So W is equal to minus mb into, again we are applying the limits, upper limit and lower limit. We have cos theta 2. Theta 2 is the upper limit, minus cos theta 1. Now we can take this negative sign into the bracket. It becomes, so here we have W is equal to minus mb into cos theta 2 minus cos theta 1. Now we are going to take this negative sign into the bracket. It becomes W is equal to mb into minus cos theta 2 minus minus cos theta 1. Minus cos theta 2 minus minus cos theta 1. That is plus cos theta 1. So W is equal to mb into minus cos theta 2. Here one negative from outside and one is already inside. So minus minus cos theta 1. It becomes plus cos theta 1. Or we can rearrange this equation once again. We get W is equal to mb into, take the positive term first, that is plus cos theta 1 minus cos theta 2. Here we are only rearranging the above equation. W is equal to mb into cos theta 1 minus cos theta 2. Is it okay?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, can you show the last slide?
Okay, okay. So here we are deriving the equation sin theta d, not deriving, integrating the equation sin theta d theta. According to mathematics, the integral sin theta d theta is minus cos theta. So we write the value of integral sin theta d theta here, that is minus cos theta. And then it is varies from the theta 1 to theta 2. And in the next step, we are applying the upper limit and lower limit. So we get minus mb into cos theta 2 minus cos theta 1. Okay, upper limit minus lower limit. Is it okay? Okay.
Ma'am.
Yes.
We are getting this minus mb because like by applying the limits.
Which one here?
Yes, ma'am, minus mb.
According to the rule of integration, we are subtracting the upper limit, the lower limit from the upper limit. Okay, that is upper limit is theta 2 minus lower limit is theta 1. That is why the negative sign is comes here.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So this negative sign is already here. Sin theta d theta is minus cos theta. And here in the next step, we take this negative outside. So it becomes minus mb into, then inside the bracket, here we are applying the upper limit and the lower limit. That is cos theta 2, then minus the lower limit cos theta 1. Then in the next step, we take this negative sign inside the bracket. It becomes w is equal to mb into minus into cos theta 2 minus cos theta 2 minus into minus cos theta 1, it is plus cos theta 1. Then in the next step, we just rearrange the equation. W is equal to mb into, bring the positive term first, that is cos theta 1 minus cos theta 2.
Yes.
Okay. Now, in this magnetic field or in this uniform magnetic field, we rotate the dipole from a stable equilibrium positions to a certain angle theta. Okay. So all of you write the next sentence. Inside the uniform magnetic field, the magnetic dipole is rotates from a stable equilibrium position to a certain angle theta. The magnetic dipole is rotates from a stable equilibrium position to a certain angle theta. Yes.
Can you say it once more?
Okay. Inside the magnetic uniform magnetic field, the magnetic dipole is rotates from a stable equilibrium position. The magnetic dipole is rotates from a stable equilibrium position to a certain angle theta. To a certain angle theta. That is, initially the magnetic dipole is in a stable equilibrium position. That is, the angle theta 1 is equal to pi by 2. This is the stable equilibrium position of the dipole. After some time, when it is placed in a uniform magnetic field, it experiences a force and undergoes a rotation. Okay, so due to that rotational effect, it is undergoes a rotation to a certain angle theta. So we can take this angle theta 2 is equal to theta. We are not knowing about this angle. It undergoes a small rotation that is equal to theta. So here the dipole is undergoes a rotation from a stable equilibrium state to a certain angle theta. So we can take the angle theta 1 is equal to pi by 2. Angle theta 1 is equal to pi by 2. Here we are going to give the values for the theta 1 and theta 2, the initial angle and the final angle. So initially the dipole is in a stable equilibrium. The stable equilibrium state of the dipole is given by pi by 2. And whenever it is placed in a uniform magnetic field, it undergoes a rotation through a certain angle theta, that is theta 2 is equal to theta. The stable equilibrium for the dipole is pi by 2. Okay, so here we are going to apply this value in this equation. It becomes W is equal to MB into, this is our equation, cos theta 1 minus cos theta 2, or we can write W is equal to MB into, here we are going to apply the values for theta 1 and theta 2. Theta 1 is the initial angle, that is the dipole is in a stable equilibrium state. We have cos pi by 2 minus cos theta. What is cos pi by 2? Cos pi by 2 means cos 180 by 2, that is cos 90. What is the value of cos 90?
Zero.
So that term cancels. Here cos pi by 2 is equal to cos 90 degree, that is equal to 0. So that term cancels. So we can write W is equal to MB into minus cos theta, or W is equal to minus MB cos theta, which implies W is equal to MB cos theta, it is the dot product. So we can write W is equal to minus M dot B. This is the work done by the magnetic dipole in a uniform magnetic field. And this work done is stored in the form of a potential energy. So we can write the potential energy, the same equation. Whatever may be the work done by the object, that much work done is stored in the form of potential energy. So we can write potential energy U is equal to minus M dot B. Okay, sorry students, it's the time. Okay, thank you children for your cooperation. We can continue the same with our next class. Thank you all and have a nice day.